it's a no-brainer why holidays associated with gifts are so popular in our day and age. People love getting gifts. We talked about it earlier, too. We give gifts to commemorate the day you were born, when you get married, even when you come into a new house. Oftentimes, a gift will show how much you mean to the person giving the gift to you. As mentioned earlier, the best gifts one can receive means a great deal more when it comes from a place of deep personal connection. I remember one particular Christmas, I had my heart set on a Super Nintendo game console. It was an unspoken tradition with my sister and I that we'd eyeball the gifts that have our names on it, and then we would nonchalantly grab each one of them and give them a good rattle just to kind of guess what was inside. So you'd shake. Ah, socks. Well, Christmas morning came, and it was time to unraft our gifts, and we'd open one gift at a time and one person at a time. So when it was finally my turn, I just feverishly unwrapped my present, and it revealed to be a Super Nintendo game controller. So it wasn't the console, but it was the controller. And I was super excited because even at a young age, I knew that if there's a controller, that means that there is a console soon ahead too. So I'm so excited. I'm like, yes, I got the Super Nintendo. It's coming. And then I look around and I look at my parents, and they have like this face like, oh no. They suddenly exclaim to me, what, that's not the console? We thought that was the whole game. Like, that's everything. Like, no, Mom, that's just the controller. The game is, like, bigger, you know? And so they're like, oh, no, we're so sorry. We thought that was that. And, you know, parents, we're cavemen when it comes to technology. And kids know that, too, for us. So then immediately when it comes to disappointment, my next emotion was I have to console my parents because they don't know any better. I mean, they're just parents, right? So I'm like, oh, it's okay. It's the thought that counts. I really appreciate it. It was a really nice gift that you know, I can play with this. This is fine. And so we move on. And then the next gift that I get, sure enough, it's the console. And I was super shocked. I had a flood of emotions. I think I called you guys liars. But it was a memorable gift. I think, you know, that it was something that I really wanted, but also maybe the presentation of it. But the point that I'm trying to make is that, you know, a memorable gift like that, I can still remember the living room, how it was all positioned. I remember where I sat. I remember the Christmas tree. I remember how all the furniture was arranged in the mobile home, and that was 30 years ago. Now, Desi can attest that I forget things 5 minutes after they happen, but so, I mean, that I can have that kind of vivid memory of something like that, that it just comes to show that a memorable gift can have an impact that lasts a lifetime. So, I said in the beginning that people love getting gifts because we're always in search of receiving that perfect gift. Now, what makes something a perfect gift, you may ask? I don't know if anybody else kind of had stopped to think, what qualifies as a perfect gift? Well, you have to have two ingredients. What it costs the person who gives the gift. So the classic re-gift of the spare toaster from your bridal shower, or the Christmas gift that you have no desire to keep, that's going to be in your closet if you don't re-gift it, those are out. So that's not going to happen. So the second ingredient is it must be necessary. So not only does it need to cost the giver a great deal, but what it offers to the one who receives it is crucial. It has to meet a need, not a desire. Desire or wants are like rain showers on the local radar right now. They can change without warning, and they're gone just like that. Well, that truth, it resonates a little harder, but it's still the truth nonetheless. Gifts that we receive from loved ones, they can come close to the perfect gift, but we can all say with confidence that nothing compares to the greatest gift of all, the perfect gift that is in our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Now let's look at those ingredients to see why that is a perfect gift in the first place. So ingredient one, what it costs the person who gives the gift. Paul so eloquently articulates the gravity of the cost Jesus paid on that fateful Friday in his letter to the church in Philippi, who though he, Jesus, was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be held on for an advantage, but emptied himself, like taking a form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself to becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So human history from its inception with Adam and Eve in the garden to you and me today, we have abused the even smallest amounts of authority or power to our own advantage. Only Jesus did not. The one who had the very right to, because he is God, he folded his pocket aces face down on the table willingly. Imagine having the authority to assign planets and stars their positions and boundaries, setting in motion ecosystems so intricate in detail that is insulting to assume that it just happened by chance, to take on flesh and bone that you created to be in your image, that your breath brought to life, and that same breath now resonates in your lungs. If that wasn't shameful enough to be subject to death, the one who is from everlasting to everlasting, and not only death, but death of the vilest offender, the public humiliation of death on a cross. No other cost can compare. Now, ingredient two, the necessity of the gift, the ones getting it. So it doesn't take much time in reviewing the status of our world that today that to come to the conclusion that we are in desperate need of a Savior. But it is also naive to assume that the world has never been so corrupt or depraved as it is today. Paul makes this point to the church communities in Rome that has been true from the very beginning, that no one can claim they are righteous or righteous by their own merits. So there is no righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. There is no fear of God before their eyes. So no matter what we do, we cannot achieve salvation for ourselves. It's like floating upstream without a paddle and then going in the wrong direction. The law was a gift that God had given his chosen people to allow his people to draw closer to him. The law itself is good, but it reveals that we are incapable of fulfilling it to its entirety. We are daily racking an accruing continuous debt that we cannot repay. The sacrificial system of atonement serves two purposes: to show the gravity of our sinful nature. The wages of sin is death. The price must be paid. There's no getting around it. And two, that this was always going to be a foreshadowing of Jesus Christ paying that debt for us once and for all. As it's shown here, all who receive salvation, it has been given to them as a gift, the perfect gift. Now that we know that salvation in Jesus Christ is the perfect gift for us, why are we so unwilling to accept it for what it is? We see from Scripture and honestly from our very own lives the truth that we cannot achieve this by our own merits, but many Christ followers today live out their lives trying to work out their own salvation. I'm no less guilty than the aforementioned. I need to earn it first, Lord, then I'll be willing to accept it. Now, it's not a far-fetched ideal, given what our nation has advocated for keys to success. you get back what you put in. Nothing worth having is free. If you want anything worthwhile in your life, you have got to earn it. Those ideals can and probably are true for our culture, but they are lies in the citizenship of God's kingdom. Life is a gift. The breath that you just took is a gift that you did not earn. Our very faith is a gift from God, because it's not from our own intellect or that our understanding. It's because that by God and God alone that we have come to know and fear him. God prompts us to abide in him, to have a desire to know him. Paul states this to the church in Ephesus when he says, "It is for by grace that you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yours. This is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Now, my father, he gave me a gold necklace when I was late teens to early 20s, and I remember being so proud to receive that gift from him. It wasn't because I perfectly obeyed every command he gave me, and I think he can attest to that. That's right. But it was because I was his son, and he loved me, and I loved him. In knowing that, I had no shame in receiving that gift, and I wore it to honor him. If someone else would have gave me that necklace, I probably would have a hard time accepting it as a gift. And that's the point I want to make this morning, is that the only way to receive this free gift of salvation is to believe wholeheartedly that you are a son or daughter of the living God, to know him as intimately as God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit that dwells in your very being. Dramatic turn page. So how do we know Yahweh instead of knowing about him? He has revealed himself in his word, what his character is. Dive into God's word at minimum daily. I think of his word like bread, our miraculous manna that has been given to us to test, to trust in him and in him alone. Like manna, whether you gather in much or seemingly little, it will meet each other's needs to its fullness. The Bible is meant to be meditated on and consumed. Bread, you can't just put in your mouth and swallow it. It has to be chewed on. It has to be digested. God's word must be on your lips, marinated in your mind. Anybody hungry yet? And repeated again and again, day after day, to fill you and sustain you. Men do not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Every word. So that means the entire Bible. From the in the beginning to the end, saying amen. Every word in between. Psalm 118 verse 10 says that your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Knowing God's word will direct you to what God's will is for your life. There are so many resources. There's so many commentaries, podcasts, audiobooks that are at our disposal right now. There is no excuse to immerse yourself in God's word. So when Jesus taught us how to pray, he didn't say to say, "Jesus, Father, who art in heaven." He invites us to the table by teaching us to say, "Our Father." I think this is just so amazing and awesome that God had not only created us in his image and sustains us in every facet of our lives, but he allows us the privilege to know him and call him our Father. That is huge. That it's an invitation to an intimate and personal relationship with the Creator. To pray for our will to mirror his, to bring petitions for our loved ones and ourselves, our neighbors, and even those that we consider our enemies. To reflect on his power and majesty, and to remember that why we're here in the first place, and that is to honor him. So through prayer, we build our relationship with God, and not only know about God, but we know him as our Heavenly Father. So just like my necklace from my father, we can all accept that gift of salvation as the perfect gift from our Heavenly Father, and we will wear it proudly to honor him. And what's good bread worth unless it's shared with somebody? It's the proper response to accepting this perfect gift. This gift is not meant to be enjoyed alone, or to be stored in the back closet, or to be opened every once in a while, or in a particular season. The perfect gift is meant to be shared with the ones that you know, the ones that you care about, those around you. Have it in your mind's eye to look for opportunities. When it comes to truly realizing it as a gift, how easy it becomes to be willing to share it with more and more people. Most times when you find something that serves a great need, we're reluctant to share it. We might even be tempted to hoard it. If you don't believe me, I'd like to take you back 2 years ago when it looked like toilet paper and plywood would replace gold and silver. The amazing thing that God's amazing, perfect, free gift is that it is an infinite source of life, love, and forgiveness. There is fullness in receiving the gift, but it reaches its full measure when the gift is shared. But this can't happen if we're unwilling to do so. It's the gift that keeps on giving. So I'm reminded of the miracle that God, through the prophet Elisha, performed for the widow. She came to Elisha for help because she owed a great debt to creditors, and they were threatening to take away her two sons into slavery to cover that debt. Elisha asked her what she had to sell, and all that was left was a little oil in a jar. So he commanded her to bring as many vessels as she could and pour the remaining oil into them that what she had gathered. Now, the oil ceased flowing only when there was no vessel left to be filled. Sharing the free gift with people around us is the same as bringing these vessels to be filled with oil. Let us keep bringing vessels to be filled with the everlasting free gift until there is no vessel left. Now, I saw this image on Facebook the other day, and it really struck me. It was the image of Jesus on the cross on the left, and then on the right, it had bold letters saying, "Jesus died for you in public, so don't live for him in private." In the wild, you'll see it time and time again when predators attack a group or a herd. The strategy is to break the pack and then prey on the ones that are on their own. Our enemy is no different. Satan prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. His goal is to break us from the body of believers. He would rather you practice a private faith than a faith that is centered on a communal bond. That is why the church is so important. It pushes us to put other people's needs above our own, to use the resources that are around you. We have all heard the verse in Proverbs that says, "Iron sharpens iron, but a man sharpens another." Let us help each other in this. If you have trouble starting a conversation, or you don't know what to talk about in regards to spreading the gospel or sharing the good news, then let's practice on each other. Let's start a conversation with those that you're comfortable with, fellow believers, so that we can sharpen our skills, that we can be like iron. And after a little while, after the service, we're going to get our coffee. Let's share something that's happened with you this week. What's where you've drawn closer to God? Where have you seen him working, or where you are praying for a petition to see him working in these trials? Utilize the resources that are offered here on Wednesday nights, coffee break on Thursdays. Young adults are thriving now in a group. And then our services after the morning service here, and on evening service too. So we use those things to learn about God, but it's also to learn about our brothers and sisters in the body here. Be involved. Whether it's in classes or the various committees that we are offered here, God has given us the privilege to be active participants in God's kingdom work. Let us not sit on the sidelines and sit idly by. So, brothers and sisters here in Stephenville and across the world, it is time to live our lives out of gratitude for receiving this free gift, the perfect gift, which is salvation through the death and resurrection of our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, to do the good works that he set before us, what he has prepared in advance for us to do, not to make us right with him, because he's already done that, not to show others how right we are with him, because no one can earn their own salvation, but as an act of gratitude and thanksgiving for giving us this perfect gift. Our response in receiving this gift is to share it with those around us and to demonstrate this to the next generation that follows until every vessel is filled with oil. We long for the day that Christ comes again, and on that day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God, the Father, forever and ever. Amen.